Hi, hello everyone. Welcome back to our channel. I'm Dr. Ramel from City Skin Clinic. Today, I thought we'd have a chat about vitamin C and its different forms. So the reason I think this is quite useful is there are lots of different types of vitamin C, and a lot of brands kind of hype one type as better than the other, but it really does cause a lot of confusion. And I thought this video would be a good way to kind of explain some of the main differences and help you decide which is better for you. Is it worth going with one type versus the other, depending on the skin type you have and the skin solutions that you're looking for? Before we start, if you're new to our channel, please don't forget to hit the subscribe button. And if you're returning to us and you haven't already, hit the notification bell so that you're alerted to our new videos. So without much delay, vitamin C, I've already discussed it in a previous video about why it's so important for your skin and the benefits it has on your skin in terms of building up collagen and skin elasticity and plumpness, in terms of firming the skin, in terms of being an antioxidant and helping protect the skin from sun damage and skin aging, helping with improve skin texture, lines and wrinkles, as well as improving hyperpigmentation and evening out the skin tone. So really, vitamin C is a wonderful ingredient if your skin can tolerate it. It'll leave you with just bouncier, softer and brighter looking skin. And I'm a massive fan of vitamin C. So not all vitamin C's are the same, and it's really important to kind of just understand the differences so that you can pick the best one for you, and also you don't necessarily waste your time and money on a formulation that might not be necessary. So one of the things to understand about vitamin C is that the most commonly found type of vitamin C and the most active form is ascorbic acid, or l-ascorbic acid. So ascorbic acid is vitamin C in its most active form, and so it's in its most powerful form. It's a water-soluble ingredient. It's usually found in serums and also creams. It gets absorbed by the skin and it starts to have the effects that we talked about, vitamin C. It's usually available in a variety of concentrations. The most common ones are 10, 15, and 20%. And the which concentration is best for you really depends on your skin. So we know that with vitamin C, you want it to be in a form that's easily absorbed by the skin, which L-ascorbic acid is. And it also needs to be at the right pH, more acidic the better. And it also needs to be at the right concentration. So too low a pH and too high a concentration are the most powerful, but also they're the most damaging to your skin. So it's a balance. Usually with vitamin C and L-ascorbic acid, as a general rule, we advise if you're someone who has dry skin or skin that's sensitive, try, use the lowest concentration, so about 10% ascorbic acid. If you're someone with very oily skin and it's not sensitive, then you may benefit most from 20%. The majority of people don't fall into either of those, and usually 15% is what most people will use. If in doubt, always use a lower concentration, and always when you're starting a new product or a new skincare ingredient, patch test it on a small area of skin before you use it. So with ascorbic acid, we know that it's very potent, we know that it's easily absorbed by the skin, and it has a full gamut of effects in terms of helping with skin aging, in terms of texture, in terms of hyperpigmentation. What's the downside? Well, a couple of things. One, because it's the most potent, it is the most likely to irritate the skin, and some people won't be able to tolerate it at all, especially if you have very dry or very sensitive skin. The other thing with it is it's the least stable. So it means that it doesn't last for very long in terms of shelf life. Once you open it, it starts to decay. So you're not really going to be, or shouldn't expect to buy a large bottle of it and expect to use it over several months. It's better to buy in small amounts and then use them that way. It's also really, really important that it comes in an airtight container. So you may have see the stoppers, or if it's something, you know, that has a tight fitting lid, because again, air will start to will help it decay more quickly. The other problem with it is it's very light sensitive, so you need to buy it in something that doesn't let the light in. So if it's a glass bottle, it should be very dark, the bottle, or if you've purchased it in a plastic container, then that container can't be see-through. Otherwise, you are risking it decaying. And when you open it quickly, put a small amount, and then close it again tightly. Store it in a cool, dark place. That's how you kind of protect your vitamin C. But it does mean that ascorbic acid, because of these problems with irritability, it's not suitable for everyone. And because of these problems with storage, some manufacturers move to other formulations to try and make it something that can keep better. And remember, the vitamin C bottle that you opened and used on your first day, the product is going to be less potent if you're using the same 3 or 4 months later, because it does decay with time. So it's worth keeping that in mind. So that's kind of led to a number of different formulations, and some of the confusion come from here. So those formulations heavily lean into the fact that they don't have ascorbic acid's shortcomings. So one of these is sodium ascorbyl phosphate. And this is a derivative of vitamin C. It is less potent than ascorbic acid. So that means, because it's not the active form, it gets converted into the skin, into your active form, but it does mean that it is less potent. So the good effect of that is, once it's applied immediately on the skin, it's less irritating. It's also more stable, and in the kind of studies that they've used it in, it's good for oily skin and acne, although there hasn't been much data on its uses for sort of aging skin. So this is, I would say, look, if you're looking at a product that has this, if you're someone with sensitive skin but you suffer from oily or acne prone skin, then this may be a positive product to grab for, especially if ascorbic acid, your skin won't tolerate it. But it isn't going to be as effective as ascorbic acid. So next on the list, and by the way, there are many, many different formulations and derivatives of vitamin C. I'm only going to mention, ascorbic acid and 5 of the main derivatives, because we don't have all day, and there is a general trend here, you'll see. So next one up on the list, so it sounds very similar, sodium ascorbate. But again, it is different. So sodium ascorbate, like sodium ascorbyl phosphate, again, they are derivatives, but they are both less potent and less irritating. There is a little bit less information about sodium ascorbate, but again, it tends to be used in vitamin C products where people are looking for something that's less irritating. And then one that gets a lot of attention is calcium ascorbate. So calcium ascorbate, or there's a brand name, you know, it's known, trademarked as ester-C. And this is, again, a form of vitamin C. It's marketed as something that is really great for sensitive skin. And one of the other positives that it had, because it's an ester, is that it's very hydrating. So vitamin C can leave the skin irritated, but also can dry it up. This is supposed to be really good for hydration. If you are someone with sensitive and dry skin, but you're looking to use vitamin C, then ester-C might be a really good alternative to consider. Next one up on the list is ascorbyl palmitate. So the reason I included this one is it's actually fat-soluble. So ascorbic acid and vitamin C derivatives tend to be soluble in water, so the serums are in usually water-based, or if it's in a cream, it's usually in a water-based cream. If you're someone with oily skin, then that might be great. The nice thing about ascorbyl palmitate is that it is fat-soluble, and so you'll often find it in very kind of emolliating creams, particularly for people with very dry skin. So this may be suitable for them. It's also shown to be far less irritating for people with sensitive skin, and so it's a good sort of, it's pitched as a good alternative. The problem is there isn't a lot of data, good hard clinical data about it, and that nothing shows that it is at all better than ascorbic acid. And that's the same with all of these others. It's just that they're good if you can't tolerate ascorbic acid. The other thing with it is it's not clear how much of the skin absorbs this, and it's not clear what percentage of the vitamin C becomes active in the skin. So it's really hard to know how effective this is compared to the other derivatives. We know it's certainly not as effective as ascorbic acid. And then last but not least, I say magnesium ascorbyl phosphate till the very end. So this is one of the vitamin C's that gets hyped up a lot, just because a lot of studies have shown that it's actually pretty much as effective as ascorbic acid, which a lot of other vitamin C derivatives we know are clearly not. This form is far, far gentler on the skin. It is less irritating than ascorbic acid, so it's great if you're someone who is prone to sensitive skin, but you also want to reap the effects of ascorbic acid and the potency of it. It's also far more stable than ascorbic acid, so it has a longer shelf life. And so when you're using it with time, it shouldn't decay as quickly as ascorbic acid. One of the other really positive things that we talked about is that actually, it's really hydrating. So if you're someone with dry skin, it's also really good and can be used in that situation. And remember, people with dry skin tend to also sometimes have, it tends to be combined with very sensitive skin. One of the nice things about it is it can be combined at the same time with other products, so things like niacinamide. So whilst, I've done a video about niacinamide already, and it's a really great ingredient to use, especially alongside things like vitamin C and retinol or retinoids, it's sometimes with niacinamide and ascorbic acid, for example, they can interact with each other, so you would use them at different times. We normally encourage that, but with this form, magnesium ascorbyl phosphate, we can certainly use them together, and they work. It works really nicely, and it's very complementary. So this might leave you thinking, well, what should I go for? So I would say, if you are somewhat keen to use vitamin C, and you don't have any skin irritation, you don't have sensitive skin, you tolerate ascorbic acid well, so you could test that with patch testing, I would probably say, in terms of cost and in terms of ease of availability and choice, you're probably going to be thinking that ascorbic acid is more worthwhile because it's the most potent form, it's very active, it's available everywhere, you can get it at any sort of budget. And if you're going to use it regularly. If you're someone with very sensitive skin, but you still want to use ascorbic acid, if you also want you need some hydration, you've got very dry skin, then you might be better off exploring something like magnesium ascorbyl phosphate. It's easy to find, but there's a limited range of products that you can choose from, and it's usually more expensive than ascorbic acid, so that's the thing to bear in mind. But it may be much better for you if you have sensitive skin, and also if you have dry skin, it's great to use with that. And then the other formulations, to be honest, there isn't really much in the way of evidence that the others are any better than these two. So I would recommend, if you are looking to start your vitamin C journey and you can tolerate it, look at ascorbic acid. If you have sensitive skin, or you've tried ascorbic acid and you didn't like it before, then have a look at magnesium ascorbyl phosphate. And then the others probably you know, it's hard to recommend them in the absence of much evidence for them. So that's kind of brings me nicely to the end of this video. I hope you found it useful. Please leave me a comment below if you have any questions about vitamin C or any skincare ingredients or products. I've left some links below to our A to Z of skincare, our vitamin C guide. Don't forget to check out our vitamin C introductory video as well. And don't forget to subscribe to this channel if you've not already and give this video a thumbs up. Until next time.